What's it like to use Windows on a Steam Deck? Given how optimized SteamOS is for Steam Decks and how much heavier Windows seems than Linux overall, it's always seemed like a no-brainer that Windows should perform worse, right? Well, Genki recently sent me their new SavePoint drive to see for myself. And honestly, my old assumptions were entirely wrong. Before we dive too deep into Windows, let's discuss my hardware and software setup process. I have an LCD Steam Deck from launch. It has an internal 512GB SSD combined with a 512GB microSD card, both of which are well over half full at this point. Most folks would likely reformat or partition one of those drives to install Windows, but for me, that'd be a bit of a hassle. I don't want to mess with the internal drive and the hundreds of gigabytes of ROMs saved to my SD card, which I'd also want accessible via Windows, don't have a good alternate home at the moment. Plus, going through all that seems like quite the commitment for something I just want to try out first. That's where the Genki SavePoint comes in. It's a really compact, MagSafe-compatible M.2 2230 enclosure that slaps onto the back of my Steam Deck with the power of magnets and an included metal ring. On its top, it has a single USB 3.2 Gen 2 port to plug into my Steam Deck and a second port for pass-through charging up to 100 watts. Most of the body is sturdy textured plastic, which gives me confidence chucking it in a bag. Meanwhile, there are magnets on the underside and an aluminum lid on the top side, acting as a heatsink for the SSD inside. That SSD is accessible by a single screw and is sandwiched between two thick thermal pads for maximum contact. All of it feels very premium, very sturdy, which is always great for something I use to store sensitive information. For the drive itself, Genki provided a single-sided 1TB PCIe 4.0 drive with my review unit, though the enclosure can also be purchased on its own, which I'm guessing will be the bigger appeal for something like a SavePoint. Any y'all who have already upgraded your internal drive likely have a spare drive just lying around waiting to be used on a project like this. Now, getting Windows onto the drive was incredibly simple. Genki's own drives come pre-installed with Windows, and it works just fine, but I decided to start fresh to test the guide they posted to their blog. It boils down to install the official Windows ISO, flash it using Rufus, and then plug it into the Steam Deck. All pretty standard. Altogether, it took me around half an hour from opening the webpage to having Windows running on my Steam Deck. Setting up Windows from there was a bit jankier though, admittedly. Due to how Steam Deck displays are manufactured, the first startup has the display rotated 90 degrees. When that's solved, I then had to install a bunch of extra drivers from Valve's website to enable things like Bluetooth and Wi-Fi. Add in the typical Windows updates in software installation, and that process likely took me another hour. Not too bad, but firmly something I needed to set aside an afternoon to work on. That requirement for a full afternoon became even more true once I started to play games. My initial assumption was that I could run Steam and use Steam input to manage controller layouts, as I've done with a myriad of other controllers, but nah. Steam straight up doesn't recognize the built-in controller beyond the default keyboard and mouse bindings associated with it. A bit frustrating, but only a small inconvenience thanks to Genki's guide. Toward the end, they recommend installing a piece of software called Handheld Companion, which became the key to Windows actually feeling a lot easier to use than expected. Handheld Companion allows for full remapping of both an in-game and desktop layout, on top of recreating the abundance of overlays and hotkeys that had been great to use in SteamOS. If you're trying this for yourself, I highly recommend mapping the touch keyboard and desktop layout toggles to at least one back button. Being able to toggle them at will makes the experience of navigating Windows much easier. And honestly, once I had it installed and tweaked the settings to my liking, most of my remaining gameplay experience was pretty seamless, beyond some random minor computing issues, typical of any handheld. And you know, so far, I'm actually really enjoying Windows on my Steam Deck a lot more than I thought I would. Performance feels smooth, battery life feels comparable to SteamOS, and applications I've wanted to use feel responsive. Any fears I had of Windows being a bit too heavy immediately vanished within the first few seconds of booting up a game. though it's definitely a different experience compared to Linux. While I've always appreciated the simplicity of how fast SteamOS can get me into a game, it's always felt a bit lacking whenever I've needed desktop mode. Here, desktop mode is the experience, and it's up to me to source whatever method I want to use to quickly get into a game. In general, it feels about as good as my dedicated Windows handheld, albeit much more comfortable to navigate due to those large, lovely trackpads. If I had to point to any gripes with my setup, it's that Valve only included one USB-C port on the Steam Deck. That means there's no display out, docking, or easy peripheral connectivity without a few extra steps. On the bright side, the SavePoint's pass-through charging works as advertised. I'd just love to connect my mouse and keyboard every once in a while without using Bluetooth. With that in mind, the SavePoint does cause one issue. It hinders laying my Steam Deck on a table without caution. Although the depth of the Steam Deck affords enough room that I won't bonk the drive by setting it down, the heat generated by the SSD has the potential to make something toasty if it gets in contact for too long. After several hours of continued use, mostly spent downloading games, the aluminum lid has gotten hot enough to burn my fingers if I purposefully held them against it for a bit too long. Not that my fingers ever get even remotely close to it during regular use, but something to remember. This, of course, is it working as intended. The heat is going outward instead of pushing back into the Steam Deck. In fact, the plastic body and surrounding surface of the Steam Deck felt no hotter than I'd expect of the system without a drive planted on the back. Unfortunately, if I want to continue dissipating heat and, well, not burn anything, I can't exactly set it down like usual. My solution's been a DeckMate kickstand while a download is taking too long. Although, I could also see folks using spare docks or kill switch cases. Whatever the choice, it feels like something to factor in to a setup like this. Luckily, despite all that, performance feels unexpectedly good, even while pushing the system a bit. Going in, I figured the number of optimizations baked into SteamOS made it the lightest weight, most performant gaming option for this device. Yet, that hasn't been the case in my testing. Games like Cyberpunk 2077 and Control felt almost identical to play between operating systems while targeting a 12-watt TDP and medium preset settings at 800p. Linux may have had a slight edge due to a little bit more frame rate consistency without additional tweaks, but neither play session felt dramatically different. Oddly enough, that's in stark contrast to Another Crab's Treasure, which provided only around 30 to 40 FPS via Steam on Linux, but a consistent 55 to 60 FPS via Game Pass. In fact, for the handful of games I've tried, Game Pass games in Windows generally tended to feel better to play than the same games on Steam, both due to performance and just a better user experience. For both Game Pass and GOG, I've had a better experience with Handheld Companion, and they've both felt just a little bit more stable than Steam overall. The Xbox app's compact mode has even felt like a good enough analog to big picture mode to start my system and quickly jump into a game. It really does feel like Windows is just one step away from a true handheld Xbox experience. Which is to say that while I'd probably head back to Linux for my Steam library, I'd have no qualms coming back to Windows for everything else. Which is great, because to me, Windows is simply a way to get easier access to Game Pass, GOG, and whatever other random games I have lying around not in my Steam library. This isn't a replacement for SteamOS by any means, but a good way to expand what this handheld is capable of. Still, seeing any games run better on Windows felt kind of surprising at first. Though, thinking it through a bit, I did remember that on SteamOS most games are still running through the Proton compatibility layer. That layer's often unnoticeable during gameplay, but I'm guessing Linux-native games or applications might even the playing field a bit. Like any rational person, I tried out Wii U emulation to test the hypothesis, and, well, you know, SIMO has native apps for both Windows and Linux these days, so it's very much a way to level the playing field as long as both versions are developed in sync. And, as expected, I actually noticed no difference in performance between the two operating systems. I clocked around 25 to 30 FPS at 720p and a 12-watt TDP in Breath of the Wild, and then, meanwhile, in Mario Kart 8, it ran close enough to its full 60 FPS to be more than playable. In both cases, the only stuttering was a result of expected shader compilation. With the current state of things, it very much feels like any performance benefits between Linux and Windows will come down to game or app-specific optimization. That's not unexpected, but also a sign that maybe Windows on Steam Deck isn't as bad an option as I would have thought before. In fact, as long as you're willing to jump over a few hurdles at the start, I'd probably recommend at least trying Windows to any Steam Deck owner who doesn't want their entire library managed by Steam. Nonetheless, there are a few additional quirks about this setup to note before we wrap things up. First, the metal ring used to attach the save point. You know, when everything's attached, there's typically no sign the save point's coming off by accident. It's all very sturdy. Unfortunately, over the course of a few weeks of testing, the metal ring that came in the box has fallen off twice when I've set the device down for a while. I've since replaced it with a metal ring I got from Mechanism a while back, which shows no sign of coming off yet, but it's a bit awkward to need to swap in a substitute. Multiple things could be going on here to make the ring fall. Maybe the back of the Steam Deck heated up too much for the ring's adhesive, maybe I didn't provide enough time for the adhesive to cure before slapping on the save point. Heck, maybe the texture of the Steam Deck just isn't great for an adhesive ring. No clue. I've mostly tended to use rings like this on top of cases. Maybe try that if you're feeling cautious. Second, Steam. Throughout my testing, Steam has resulted in a few full system crashes while trying to play games. Browsing through past Reddit posts, it seems like these crashes aren't unheard of, and sadly haven't been entirely resolved through Valve's driver updates. However, I did find at least one post that suggested installing AMD Adrenaline to get around some supposedly outdated drivers from Valve. As far as I can tell, AMD Adrenaline is not actually available for Steam Decks, yet after going through the initial installation process offered through AMD's website, the installer did seem to add a bunch of drivers to my system. Since then, Steam's been more stable and I haven't had any crashes not attributable to my own stupidity. So hey, if you're going through a similar situation, I'd say give it a shot. But in general, you might also just consider using SteamOS for Steam games, if you can. And then finally, number three, let's talk price and Windows licenses. A SavePoint by itself costs $50, with a 1TB drive selling for $80 or more these days from reputable brands. For a flexible setup like this, that you could unplug and use with other systems, $130 isn't bad. However, doubling that to $260 for a Windows license might strain your budget a bit more. So before shelling out to activate Windows, consider if you actually need it. I've yet to activate Windows for any of my testing, and I've run into zero issues while playing games. Occasionally, a watermark does pop up saying that I need to activate Windows, but it's tended to go away after restarting the system. To be honest, if your sole purpose is to set up Windows to play games, you probably don't need to pay for Windows at all, or could delay buying a license for a bit. That is, unless you have an OLED model. Without activation, I can't personalize my system, which means no custom wallpaper and no dark mode. For my LCD model, that's perfectly fine. But for OLED users, that, alongside the occasional ever-present watermark, might not be good for display longevity. To wrap things up, Windows on a Steam Deck is actually pretty damn good now. The setup's relatively simple, and games play at least as good as they do on SteamOS. There's no real downsides I've noticed to navigation or efficiency. At the same time, having the ability to easily run it off of an external drive that I can remove whenever I'd like without sacrificing portability makes it all much easier to experiment with without messing with my internal drive or SD card. For cases like this, convenience can be oddly important, you know? And of course, there are some general caveats to a setup like this, such as, well, Steam is a bit more finicky in Windows. If you don't have a guide going in, installing something like Handheld Companion isn't going to be obvious, and, well, you'll lose your only USB-C port. Beyond that, for someone looking to play games only accessible via Windows, now's as good a time as any to give it a shot. And the Genki save points, a method as good as any to get you there. Of course, those have been my thoughts. Now, I'd love to know y'all's. Have you been thinking about trying out Windows on your Steam Deck? Does something like the SavePoint seem like the right tool for your own needs? Let me know down in the comments. Also, as always, if you found this video interesting or informative, go ahead and give it a like to let me know, and then get subscribed for more video game tech videos in the future. This video was made possible thanks to an early review sample of the SavePoint alongside a 1 TB SSD provided by Genki. As with all of our other product coverage, they didn't have any editorial input into the making of this video. They're seeing it for the first time alongside y'all. If you're interested in picking up a SavePoint for yourself, I'll have a link to their product page in the video description. I'll also have links down there to their setup guide and handheld companion in case y'all want to give this a shot. Meanwhile, if you're interested in some of their other products, maybe check out my previous review on their ridiculously compact Shadowcast capture card. It's still something I keep in my toolbox today for random projects or when my bigger Elgato card has a fit. But that's going to be all for this video though. Thank you so much for watching all the way until the end. Until next time, catch you later.